général d'un soliste, le numéro 7, Jonas Sagas, numéro 11, Rachel Smith, le numéro 12, Ernesta Cedarvicius, le numéro 14, Saronas Venusis, le numéro 50, Zélimatras Skokas, et le numéro 9, Marius Valencias, le coach Andrew Postic, assisté de Justas Girios et Vitas Ousas. Dans quelques instants, présentation de l'équipe du SWB, je vais s'y aller juste avant. Voici Isola Cheer Squad.
Hello and welcome into Country Hall in Liège, Belgium for this European North Basketball League playoff matchup between RSW Liège and Uniclub Casino Juventus. Alongside Victor Mansure, I'm Craig Feta, and we're so glad you can be with us wherever you're tuned in from around the world for what we hope will be a playoff win for Group B Liège against the top team in Group A. Victor, Liège is going to have to bring their A game tonight against a big experienced Juve team. It has a number of players that can hurt you on any given night. Liège, of course, is the same way. If they're healthy, if they have their regular roster, it's tough to stop Angel Rodriguez, Jamil Agüens, EJ Anosike, and AJ John. They have the talent, Victor, to take on anyone in their domestic league or in the ENBL.
Yeah, Craig, I agree with you. Bring their A game. And also, you know, the fact that you're playing at home, this is a playoff game. Like you said, they have enough firepower. They have enough weapon. Now, can you put that together throughout the 40 minutes? You know, obviously this Juventus team has got a school over there in Lithuania about their program and how they can build to be competitive. So if you're Liège, you try to bring that out of the gates and really establish your game from the tip-off.
Juve comes into this one 6-1 on the regular ENBL season, led by Ryan Taylor and Sarunas Benicius. But in their last game against Bakken, they had four players in double figures and 10 different guys score, Victor.
Yeah, Craig, and that's what's going to have to do. You see, like, spread the wealth, right, if you're Liège. Make sure that, you know, you can put enough your guys in position to score, and then that's going to create some confidence on the defensive floor and focus on Juventus, their main weapons, you know. Obviously, stop the transition game. Make sure they dominate the glass. And if they can win the free throw battle as well, those three things are going to really help them out.
Juventus led by a couple of Americans, Ryan Taylor from Indianapolis, a 2017 Marshall product, first player in Marshall history to reach 1,500 points, 800 rebounds, and 250 assists. Conference USA All-Defensive Team in 2017. Last I could tell, he was playing semi-pro in the U.S. in 2019. You've also got Joshua Newkirk, played at Pitt from 2013 to 15, and then Indiana from 16 to 18. His best season was for IU in 16-17. He averaged 9 points, 3 rebounds, 3 assists over 34 games. He's been in the G League, the Czech Republic, and Japan. And you've got Deshaun Scucci-Smith, a 2017 Dayton product. As a senior for Dayton, 13.8 points, 4.5 rebounds, first team All-Atlantic 10. He's played in Australia, the G League, Greece, Serbia, Poland. Then you've got TJ Starks, Texas A&M, Cal State Northridge. He was a Qatari League champion in 2023 with Al Rayyan. He was first team All-Big West. And then you've got the domestic players. You've got Zygmantas Skoutsis, averaging 8.9 points, 3.7 rebounds. He had 12 points against Bakken in their last regular season ENBL game. They've got Ernestas Sedorevicius, 7 games, 5.7 points, a 56% three-point shooter. I mean, you look up and down this lineup, and you don't know where to try to defend.
Yeah, you don't know where to defend because, Craig, you see, like you just mentioned, there's two big schools here for Juventus. Obviously, you know, the domestic players and the powerhouse that Lithuania is, you know, with their program, just, you know, they build guys, man. They put a lot of hours in the gym. And then you add on top of that, you know, American players with a vast curriculum, Division I player, big-time players. So that's going to come out, that's going to sum out for a competitive squad, right? So if you're on the edge, obviously you're looking down the roster and you're trying to, okay, let's focus on some key aspects here, you know, defending the three-point shots, like we said, winning the transition, the fast break points, being the better team on the rebound, on the glass. Because of that, Craig, this Juventus team just has a lot of firepower they can bring, and, you know, that's how they got to the playoffs.
Juve coached by Oliver Kostić, and he's starting tonight. Ryan Taylor, Ivan Pranis, Evaldis Saulis, Jonas Žakas. I'm sorry, he's not starting Žakas. Scucci-Smith and Zygmantas Skoutsis, starting lineup for Juve tonight. And for RSW Liège and head coach Alex Zampier, we're going to see Ije Anosike, Bram Bogerts, Angel Rodriguez, Kevin Tumba, and Anthony Cambo. One addition for RSW Liège, Olivier Trois-Fontaines back with the team. He has not played since December 28th against Brno. He's got 5 ENBL games under his belt, averaging 12.8 points per game, 2.2 rebounds, 3 assists, shooting 39% from three-point range. And he's a guy that we've seen absolutely torch the nets from three-point range. He could be a huge boost for Liège tonight.
Yeah, you know, Trois-Fontaines, he uses his name, you know, he just shoots threes and is able to make them. He can put points up in a hurry, Craig. And I'll tell you what, I'm glad he's back. I'm glad we're back. I'm glad Liège is in the playoffs. And because we have seen, you know, this Liège team, especially at home, when they can play well, you know, starting from the point guard and all the way to Tumba's presence inside, they can really be competitive, you know, and the coaching staff know that. Playing at home here, can Liège be the ones pushing the tempo right from the gate, you know, and put Juventus up against the wall? Because, you know, Craig, you look at Utenis Juventus, they're sitting at 6-1. So this is a team that know they can win this league, but if you're the edge, the playoffs have just started, none of that matters. Let's make sure we make the home factor a factor.
You mentioned Kevin Tumba a moment ago, having a monster year both in BNXT play as well as ENBL play. 8.6 points, 10.1 rebounds, that leads ENBL. 1.7 blocks per game also leads ENBL. Angel Rodriguez, 7.5 assists per game leads ENBL. And then you've got EJ Anosike, 13.3 points per game. You got Ibrahim Dumbia coming off the bench, Moussa Noderman coming off the bench, Brooke Lemaire coming off the bench, and Olivier Trois-Fontaines. It's going to be a fun night here tonight, and we are underway, our officials tonight. Proweki Geller and Urbanovitz. Liège in their dark blue uniforms as Anthony Cambo travels.
Yeah, they ran the pick and roll. The ball came to the elbow, Craig, and Cambo thought he had enough time to shoot that. But, you know, as the defender came through, he just lost his steps.
Which is on the handoff to Vranis. Back up top to Scoochie Smith. Shot clock at 8.
And that's what Angel Rodriguez does. He recognizes the pocket pass, so he's always with his hand trying a deflection. That time he extended his foot to the referee side and gave him a fresh 14.
I assume that's what happened, but I never saw the kick. All of a sudden I just saw Tumba end up with the ball. So both teams unable to score in their first possessions, and then driving and dunking. EJ Anosike gets Liège on the board.
Yeah, and Anosike, Craig, you know, they're gonna leave him open. That time they left him too open. He just drove down the lane, but they're gonna leave him open. Let's see what kind of decision making he does. Is he gonna be an outside shooter, or is he gonna keep attacking the rim?
Don Brunis gets his first 2 points of the game, and we're knotted up at 2. Welcome in wherever you're watching in from. This is Victor Mansure. I'm Craig Feta. Glad you can be with us for this ENBL playoff matchup. A 2-game series, home and home, aggregate points. So it's not a best of 3 where you have to win 2 of 3. You just play 2 games, and whoever has the most points after 2 games advances. As Angel Rodriguez gets his first 2, and it's a 4-2 lead for Liège.
Yeah, he did a great job getting to the paint, faked the big man, and then went up and under the famous step through, and a nice finish on that scoop. And that's what Angel Rodriguez does, Craig. We've seen him, you know, in the play with the Puerto Rico national team at the Puerto Rican League here for Liège for the past 2 years. And he's a guy that puts a lot of pressure on the defense. And when he's on, when he can keep his turnovers low, he is really an upgrade for this squad.
And Victor, talk about the progression of Liège over the past 2 years. Last year, Liège struggled to even make the playoffs. They were like the last team in on the silver side of things in BNXT. And now here they are, they're in the elite gold playoffs for BNXT domestic play. And they made the playoffs in their first year in ENBL play.
Yeah, and you know what, Craig? That really goes from having structure, right? You can just see Liège now, they have their established calendar. They're investing more on the team. We've seen that some pieces remain the same. Ana Rodriguez Tumba, who got called for the offensive foul there, a smart defensive play, just stopping while he's running the trailer without looking. We've seen guys, Campbell himself, Lemaire as well. So we've seen guys stay with the team. And, you know, as you stay, you start to learn how to play with each other. They got the sponsorship of Burger King now. So just an overall, the program is really, you know, really getting up to par. So you can see Liège not only this year, but hopefully next year as well, being super competitive.
Cambo comes away with the steal and then a foul on Jonas Jacques. There's Anosike. Back up top, picks up the dribble. Now Rodriguez, shot clock at 8. Angel from the left elbow, tried to pass it in and gets kicked by Ryan Taylor. And a nice break for Liège as the shot clock was winding down. They get a fresh 14 out of it.
Yeah, because his thing is decision making. He had the right lane open, could have gone himself as he crossed over, ran out of room, and then on the bounce pass, got a fresh 14 on the kick. But, you know, with Angel Rodriguez, his thing is really the decision making. They're going to go, Craig, they're going to go as far as he goes, right? If he has an efficient game, this team is going to play well.
Gambo travels again. He took, I think, 5 or 6 steps that time.
Yeah, didn't establish his pivot foot well, and then didn't have enough balance to stop on the dime. Ended up, you know, stepping a few times more.
Ronis outside to Jacques. Now back up top to Taylor. Taylor picks up the dribble outside to Jacques for 3. No good. Tip is up and in by Scooches. And now Juventus on top 6-4.
Yeah, Scooches took advantage of this 2-3 zone that Liège is playing, recognized that nobody was boxing him out on that weak side and just came flying through.
And Osike airmails the 3-point attempt, and here comes Juve back the other way.
And they're going to leave him open, Craig. They recognize that Anasiki struggles with his outside shot. So there's a reason why he's so open for that and ended up not hitting anything. So he's going to have to make a decision. Does he stay out there and shoot the 3? Does he step in to shoot the short 2 in a higher percentage, or is he going to take the ball direct every time?
In the last ENBL game against Cholet, and Osike, just 2 points, 2 rebounds, and 2 assists in that game. Well below his 13.3 per game average. Little jump hook, pops out. I don't know how that came out of there, but Liège will take it. Rodriguez behind the back. Now to Cambo, and a foul away from the ball. That's going to be on Scooches.
Yeah, because the moment Jamel Hagans check in, Liège is looking for him inside, right? They're looking for that position and just some battle for the position. And Skuskas got called for the reach and pulling his chair, Craig.
Jamel Hagans, the one-man dunk contest as Cambo airballs that one. A couple of ugly shots from Liège in the early going. Now Cambo up ahead. Bogaerts couldn't finish, but there is Jamel Hagans, and we're tied up at 6.
That's right. Things are not going for you on the outside. Attack the rim and check those glasses. Put it nice and in for an easy deuce.
Jacques for 3. That rattles out. Scooches the rebound. He draws the foul. That'll be the 3rd team foul on Liège.
Yeah, Campbell gave up the position here, so had nothing to do but to try to reach. You see right there the swipe through. Easy call for the ref, especially the motion, right? The hands coming from the top all the way down. You really have to be on target. And target is this 3 right here, Craig.
Yeah, Scooches drains the 3-pointer, and it's now a 3-point lead for Juve, 9-6. Scooches, 33% free throw, or rather 3-point shooter. Splash that one. Now Cambo on the drive, left side. Fades away and hits. Liège back
well under
control.
No, Campbell got himself in rhythm with the 2 steps and a nice turnaround, but they confuse on the defense. I mean, Liège has been playing the 2-3 from the tip, right, Craig? So there should be no reason why they're leaving a man open on the left side.
More graphic, not correct. Juventus has 11. 3-point lead, 11-8. 4:53 to play in this first quarter. Up next for Liège, they have a game Friday in BNXT Elite Gold Play. 8 p.m. local time, 3 p.m. Eastern Daylight in the U.S. against Lanstedt in the playoffs. Whistle, but no stoppage. Now up ahead to Bogaerts, and he jacks it with the right hand.
I heard a whistle too, my friend. I thought everybody stopped except the game, and then we got a dunk on the other side.
Taylor's shot won't go.
I tell you what won't go either, Craig, is the 6 turnovers if you're Liège. Just too many turnovers, you know, under 5 minutes. On a playoff game like this, they need everything they can at the rim, you know, taking a percentage shot and not turning the ball over.
Taylor hits the first free throw. He's a 67% free throw shooter. Waiting to see who that foul was on. Both free throws good for Taylor. It's 13-10. Foul was on Angel Rodriguez.
See right here, Juventus, you know, switching things up, picking up full court, Craig. You like that. You like the fact that they're switching up and putting the edge, you know, in challenging situations, have to figure it out.
Higgins gets his own tip, and Liège back to within one at 13-12. Nice way to
because you're going to run the pick.
Get a,
right, you get a staff for the rebound.
Yeah.
That's right, my friend. And a lot of guys know how to do that. You know, it's just knowing how to score. I mean, Jamel Higgins, the moment he comes in, he can check the glass, he can go himself, or he has a nice touch from the outside.
Foul whistled on Aiden Pinava. Liège already over the limit. For Juve, that's just their third team foul. Hey, you mentioned six turnovers for Liège already. Cambo's got two of them. Higgins, that's good from 18 feet on the right wing. And
hey,
Liège,
man, I'll tell you what.
Top 14-13.
If Liège wants to be on top tonight, I mean, honestly, and this should not be a foul here. I disagree with the call. He got there on time because, I mean, Jamel Higgins, I'm going to play my offense through him all night, Craig, until Juventus finds a solution. I mean, this guy, he's tough with the ball. He gets good positioning, and he also has the outside touch. So, I mean, I'm playing through him every possession down court.
Gucci Smith to the free throw line, 75% free throw shooter, averaging 7.9 points per game in ENBL play for UA. Gucci's been in Australia, the G League, Greece, Serbia, Poland, and now Lithuania. With UA back on top by one, 15-14. Rodriguez kicks out to Bogerts for three. Splash!
Yeah, Bogerts. They needed that, Craig. You know,
Liège back on top by two and a timeout on the floor. 3:08 to play, first quarter. Go ahead, Victor.
Yeah, Craig, you know, knowing that Angel Rodriguez is able to get to the lane, if you're the outside shooter, you got to be ready. Nice driving dish. And Bogerts, you know, who's a very, Bram Bogerts, who's a decent outside shooter, made that one count.
Game two of this series, a week from today, March 20th, will be at Juventus. Game two. And then you total up your points. And the one with the most points after two games moves on. So
you gotta keep that in mind.
Whoever's up at the end, you won't see whoever's up at the end of this game, or even who's down. You will see these teams playing until the 40th minute, because you have to worry about point differential. You're not going to see anybody giving up any possessions.
That's right. That's right. You know, point differential, playing with the regulation under your sleeve, right? Just knowing that the point, the plus or minus here is the advantage you're going to take into next game. So this is a 80-minute game or 80-minute matchup, not just a 40.
And did I hear another whistle? There's a whistle.
Yeah, I think there was
somewhere.
Just a,
I don't know where.
Yeah, I think there's a missynchronization, Craig, between the image and the audio real quick. You see, it's going to come. There's going to be a foul right here. So it's a couple of seconds of a delay.
Oh, yeah.
You see right here, Trois-Fontaines perhaps try to make a play. We're going to get a call and then a replay after that.
I don't.
Let's see.
Starks into the game for Juventus. This is his first game with the team.
And that's what Ana Rodriguez does best, Craig. As soon as that ball goes on the floor, my brother, he's coming at it viciously, quickly, you know, that low center of gravity. He pretty much picked the pocket of the post player on the dribble. It got fouled afterwards. So a steal for Mr. Rodriguez at his best.
Higgins now, same spot he shot from before. And it's 19-17 Liège, 2 minutes to play first quarter.
Yep, Higgins instant bucket. I'm going through him every play down court until Juventus finds an answer, brother. I mean, again, he can knock the outside shot, so they're gonna have to respect it. They're gonna have to come contest, and then he can just dribble out and find open lanes. So once again, I'm calling this play for Jamel Higgins here every trip down the court until they find an answer.
Higgins passes down to the block. Turnaround jump shot by Anosike is good.
That's it. That's the decision, man. Big body, you know, just big man inside. That's an easy call there on Jamel Higgins as he stick his foot. And this is close to an unsportsmanlike, almost two. But you know, if I'm on a secret, Craig, you know, the big body of his, most bully guys down low and get himself easy buckets.
Yeah, that was kind of just a weird play by Higgins right there. This 4-point lead for Liège, biggest lead of the game for either team. Now it's cut back down to three after the free throw by TJ Starks. Both free throws good. Jamel Higgins in the last ENBL game had 17 points, 4 rebounds against Cholet, and there's Kevin Tumba.
Yeah, man, Kevin Tumba, we love when he goes up like that. It was like he got pushed a little bit in the back, but it didn't matter, my friend. He jumped forward and dunked that ball.
Starks loses his footing, and then he gets a shot blocked by Lemaire. There's Trois-Fontaines on the right side. He launches the three. Flash! Olivier Trois-Fontaines doing what he does. You leave him open,
what he does,
you give
Craig.
Him just a crack, and he will absolutely torture you from outside.
Well, aren't there Trois-Fontaines, my friend? He knows exactly what he's stepping into right close to that line and make the defensive pay with the three-point play.
Lead was 7, down to 5 now.
Maybe 2-for-1 here.
Yep. Tumba to Lemaire. Back inside to Tumba.
Oh, left-handed.
Jump hook. No good, but Anosike the rebound. Oh, and then Anosike has his pass intercepted by Jacques. And then at the other end, TJ Starks goes up and draws the foul on Brooke Lemaire. Boy, that went all kinds of wrong for Liège. They had a chance to go 2-for-1, turned it over, and then they possibly give up the three-point play here. They go for a 7-point lead.
Just like the coaching staff wanted to do, Craig, you know, this is exactly what they asked for, but not. You know, if you're going to foul a guy, make sure he doesn't go up for the three-point play.
Alex Zampier standing in front of the Liège basket looking like somebody stole his cat. Second free throw, no good, so it's 26-23. Clock at 5 now, 4. And a foul called.
Mm-hmm. But I like what Anosike has done. He is of late, Craig. You know, he's posted up before. He's trying to get the position. This time he attacked the basket himself, and he got fouled. So if I'm on a CK, this is the adjustment you made, man. Didn't go your way from the outside shot in the beginning. No problem. We're going to start taking this ball to the rack.
And Osike, a 62.5% free throw shooter, looking at those gold kicks.
Mm-hmm. This looks like you and I, man, on the Friday night, brother. You know,
yeah,
we're getting ready. We're getting ready to showcase our game. And on the CK
Victor,
showcase,
I promise you make
those
look a lot
here.
More stylish than I would.
You know, I think I'll stick with basketball, brother. I think I'll stick with basketball, you know. And I'm glad Liege sticking with it. After not a good start with the six turnovers, putting up 28 points in the first quarter here, Craig, is a good start for them.
Yes, lead 28-23 after one quarter. We're back in a moment live from Country Hall.
Is watching basketball at 3 in the morning enough? No, of course not. So you always wanted to be part of the team, your own basketball club, in your own backyard. What if I said you could? ENBL. 9 European countries, 15 pro teams, 60 games a season. The fastest growing basketball league in Europe. In the arena, on TV, or streaming live on your phone. Reach out to us and join the ENBL family. ENBL, right here in your backyard.
Welcome back to Country Hall in Liège. After one quarter, RSW Liège leads the club Casino Juventus by the score of 28-23. Game one of this European North Basketball League playoff series. After one quarter, Liège 66% overall from the floor, 2 of 4 from three-point range, 2 of 2 from the free throw line. Juventus 53% overall, 1 of 6 from beyond the arc, 6 of 7 from three-point range. From the free throw line. Liège leading the rebounding battle 9-5. 5 turnovers for Juve and 7 in that first quarter for Liège. They took much better care of the ball in the second half of that first quarter than they did in the first. E.J. Anosike, 5 points. Graham Bogarts, 5. Angel Rodriguez, 2. Kevin Tumba, 2. Anthony Cambo, 2. Jamel Hagans, 8 off the bench. And Olivier Trois-Fontaine, 3. So Liège already with 7 players scoring. For Juventus, Ryan Taylor, 8 points. Vranis has 2. Scucci Smith, 2. Scuchas has 3. PJ Starks, 4. Penava, 4. And Vinicius has 2. And that 3-pointer is up and good for TJ Starks, and we're tied at 28.
Yeah, Liège went with the zone defense in the first, trying to slow down the outside shot of Juventus, and now switches their strategy in the second quarter and back-to-back outside shots for Juventus. So you might want to assess here if they score a bucket.
And a 7-0 run to start this second quarter for Juve, and take one more bucket, and Alex Ampere is going to call timeout. And a travel. There's another turnover for Liège. Their 8th. And off to Starks. Side to Scuchis, now a handoff. Penava. beg your pardon, that's Sedorovicius. Goes off
play,
of his
man.
Hand,
he
out of bounds. Yeah.
He was forcing his way, pretty much posting up the player from the elbow position, and still were able to turn his neck and see that no help was coming, and finish it at the rim. Just couldn't get the basket to go, but well played.
DJ Anosike soars in and scores. Boy, if he didn't get fouled there, I think we might have seen the dunk of the century.
Yeah, Craig, and I'm glad that's how he's playing right now. You know, we mentioned this before. This is a guy with so much force, you know. When he puts his weight, you know, and his jumping ability going towards the basket, it's very hard for the defenders to be able to contest without fouling.
Janosike, 6'7", leads the three-point play. Janosike from East Orange, New Jersey. Started collegially at Sacred Heart, finished at Tennessee in 2021. Played in the G League, Canada, and France before coming to Liège.
That's troubles right there. That is troubles right there, my friend. Starks just doing whatever he wanted on that pick and roll. He pretty much could have pulled up. He said, oh, not yet. Let me find a better one, and he did, man. So
Ogert's the pretty pass into the lane, tipped in by Tumba. Oh, quick move by Starks. Rodriguez finally caught up with him. He launches the three, missed. Kevin Tumba the rebound. Starks already 7 points. Now at the other end, Graham Bogerts with the left hand gets the layup to go in. And Liège back on top by three. And now Juve wants timeout. So Alexandre, Victor, did not take a timeout there. He let his team figure it out on the floor. Actually, Zampier takes the timeout here. I figured that was a Juventus timeout.
Yeah, I think there's two things they need to address here, Craig. One is, you know, when they go man-to-man, because they played well that zone defense in the first quarter, and they've given up too many shots here for Utena's Juventus in the second quarter. And then the other thing they got to address is how are they going to guard, number one, Mr. Starks? I mean, this is a left-handed player who is quick to create his own shot. And also, if he gets to the lane, can find open guys. So he's got 7 points already. In 7 points tried, he's got 7 points himself. So I think that's why the coaching staff, Mrs. Ampere, said, hold on a second, we got to talk things over. Because, you know, the advantage that we had has just evaporated here in the second quarter.
If that trend holds up, Starks, in just 5 minutes and 11 seconds of play, he's got 7 points. That'll cause your efficiency to skyrocket. Liège back on top by three, though, 35-32 as we approach. Now under 7 minutes to play in this second quarter. Again, so glad you can be with us wherever you're tuned in from around the world. Starks misses that one. There for the rebound is Vinicius. Alongside Victor Mansure, I'm Craig Feda. Graham Bogerts grabs that rebound, and here comes Rodriguez. Has Rodriguez even shot the ball? Yeah, he's 1-for-1. As Bogerts.
Yeah, he took that up and under, Craig, you know. But I'll tell you what, he's got a couple of turnovers.
Right.
And we're going to keep, you know, really putting this in perspective, because I think they go as far as he goes, right? And we have seen this guy be the MVP of the BSN, the Puerto Rico Basketball League, Baloncesto Superior Nacional. So he can really put up numbers, get the assists, get steals. We've seen him have triple-double watches with just enough steals. There's a technical foul here on the coach.
Yeah.
While we're talking about Andre Rodriguez and his impact in the game, the Juventus coach, just Mr. Kostic, just didn't have, they hadn't let the referees know there's something going on.
Yeah, I was looking at the stat page. I didn't see what he did there. Rodriguez hits the free throw.
Sometimes the referee just gets too close. They were going to inbound the ball. The ball was going to go back on the sideline, and the referee, you know what, took the meeting and just let him know what was on his agenda. Yeah, see, that's what Rodriguez is saying. The ball should be taken on the sideline. Yep, that's where they were, and the referee just got too close to Coach, and Coach let his ear got warm a little bit.
What a veteran player will get you. Now outside to Sedorovicius, his three-pointer, no good. Tumba the rebound. Rebound number four for Kevin Tumba. Rodriguez zips the pass to the baseline. Anosike spins his way in, nothing there. Cambo launches the three, splash!
That's what he's in there for, Craig. You know, just be ready to shoot. As soon as the ball came from the inside to the outside, no hesitation, once you step into the three.
Biggest lead of the game now for Liege at 9, 41-32. And as we've said before, Victor, this team, Liege, they can compete with anybody at this level in Europe. When they play well, I mean, they can do it inside, they can do it outside. They've got shooters, they've got scorers, they've got athletes. They can rebound.
Yep.
But then when the wheels come off, and we've seen it happen, it can get pretty ugly. But when they're right, they're as good as any team around. Up ahead to Anosike. Off the glass, no. There's Tumba for the putback, and he jams it home with two hands, and Liege is rolling.
And there's an example right there, Craig, to what you're saying. Transition from Ayo Rodriguez, got the ball on the wing. Anosike just couldn't finish, but Mr. Tumba, Mr. Rebound, grabs the rebound, goes up with it, and throws it down.
Taylor's three-pointer misses. He gets it back. Scucha's driving baseline. Kicks it out. Three on the way. CJ Starks won't go. Anthony Cambo the rebound. Cambo pushes it with a couple of Juventus players behind him. Now Anosike for three. Anosike rips that rebound out of the hands of Starks. Now Bogerts for three. Missed. Tumba. He's going to draw the foul over the back of
Man. Yeah, you hate these fouls, Craig, because, you know, just as we got the energized from an offensive play, a hustle play from Anosike, Kevin Tumba is trying to do the same thing, try to get his team extra possessions, and just perhaps not enough. You know, you're fighting for the box out already. Let them play and see who comes up with the possession.
Ronis. Smith.
That's a steal.
Stolen away. Rodriguez behind the back.
Oh,
Cambo ends up with it. Now Rodriguez for three. Just missed. Tumba fighting for the rebound. Saved in bounds. But actually, I think Tumba was on the baseline when he saved it. So that's going to be Juventus ball with 3:53 to play. And now Tumba thought he was coming out. Alex Zampier says, no, big fella. Back on.
Check. Yeah, we need you inside. And you saw right there just a decision-making fast break that they needed to score, just couldn't come up with anything.
Deshaun Smith with one of the coolest nicknames around, Scoochie.
Yeah.
Or Juve.
And he tried to scooch that shot in, man, after he got fouled. He recognized and then just kind of twisted his body and tried to flip that in. Almost got it to go.
First free throw is up and in. Lead cut down to 10. I know we talked about this several years ago at one of the tournaments we were at in South America, Victor. You didn't really have a nickname when you played, did you?
I did not have a nickname, man. They called me by my last name. I'll take that, you know, be able to represent my family, you know, through our family name. But not a nickname itself, man. I have... Now, I've got plenty of comparisons, man. But, you know, obviously being here from Brazil and people looking over the NBA, they've said a bunch of stuff from Larry Bird to Dirk Nowitzki. You know, I'll take those, man. Obviously, my game, not even close to them. Maybe perhaps just a physical aspect. And what about this physical play right here from
Rodriguez? How did he do that?
Got it to go, Craig. Got it to go.
That was some Facundo Campazzo wizardry there.
Yes, it was. I think it got blocked, and it got the right angle to just go off the glass. But I don't know, Rodriguez walking out like he knows exactly what was going on.
Yeah, I don't think he planned that. But and now after the three-pointer by Juve, Alex Ampere takes timeout. What's the biggest, most ferocious animal you have in the Brazilian rainforest? That should be
probably one of the. Yeah, I see. I see what you're doing there, my brother. Or you know, one of the tigers there. You know, not a lion, but we have tigers. I'll take one of those.
Okay. What's Portuguese for tiger?
A tigre. Tigre.
Tigre.
Yep. We have here.
Got a little ring to it.
Yeah, of course. Of course, my friend.
See fans enjoying the game here at Country Hall here in Liège, Belgium, just west of the N63 near Boncel. What a great atmosphere for watching basketball. It's just a perfect venue. And the fans really get into it. They've supported Liège. The support has just continued to build over the last couple of years, and they've been rewarded with their team advancing to the NXT Elite Gold playoff status this year, and now the playoff game in the European North Basketball League. The future is bright for Liège as Kevin Tuba's pass a little bit too high and sails out of bounds.
Checking in is Mr. Noderman. And we know that Noderman is going to bring in the hard play. And as soon as he was denied, he tried to cut. But Tumba just overthrew that pass.
Gucci Smith's three-pointer is up and good.
Yeah, so we've seen Craig.
Lead down to 5 from 11 just a moment ago.
Exactly, you know, because Utenas Juventus, they can really put down the lead away. Swap Fontaine hits with the three from his own. But this is a team Juventus that can put up numbers in a hurry, Craig.
Second three by Swap Fontaine. He's got 6. Now a foul on Moussa Noderman as he bumps Juventus Scoochus. Free throw bounces off right side for Scoochus. He's a 54.5% free throw shooter in ENBL play. It's the second. Coming up on 2 minutes to play, second quarter. Liège leads by 7. They've led by as many as 11. Now Higgins. Jamel Higgins from 17.
And he looked like he winded down, like he's lost some weight, Craig, you know, looking sharp there. But what has not winded down is his jump shot ability, man. He recognized that his player was just helping a little bit. He stepped into the shot. And this is a shot, Craig, that has gone away from the game a little bit. Guys are either shooting a three-point shot or going towards the basket. So, you know, the perimeter shot is a forgotten art but not forgotten for Jamel Higgins. He's knocked down his third shot from the perimeter.
Higgins with 8 points. EJ Anosike with 13 for Liege. That three nearly banked in for Trois Fontaines, but he gets fouled. So he'll go to the free throw line for three free throws. He's an 87% free throw shooter in the NBL play.
Yeah, that big body of his.
13.
You see, Craig, you know, you were mentioning just Trois Fontaines aggressive. That long body of his just comes out knowing what he wants. And the defender, recognizing that Trois Fontaines is going to shoot, just got too close. So, you know, we always say the value of having a guy knowing his role, right? Just you know what he's going to bring, and that's what Trois Fontaines brings. He's going to shoot his shots. He's going to put pressure on the defense, and you feed off of that.
One more coming for Trois Fontaines, and he books all three of them. And the lead is back to 10, 53-43, inside of a minute and a half to play second quarter. Pass outside to Starks. Pulls up along the baseline. Now Brunis underneath. Tough reverse layup. Oh my goodness, with his back to the basket. Ernestas Sedarevicius.
Acrobatic play, athletic play, just able to twist his body and finding enough angle to finish that shot.
Noderman draws the foul. He'll go to the line for a pair. We've had a chance to watch Moussa Noderman develop over the last 2 years, Victor. He's a guy who is very close to being that guy who can take over a game. He's on the verge. He's got the athleticism to do it. 6'7", just 22 years old. He had 13 points and 5 rebounds against Cholet in the last ENBL game. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of neat to put it all together.
Yeah.
A little better on defense.
You know, And maturity will bring you that, Craig. You know, as he goes, as he puts the mileage in, he's able to put those triggers together, you know, and really put in a nice season or a nice, decent amount of games. And what he has worked on as his free throw shooting, he used to shoot it with his right hand. Now we see him shooting with his left hand. So, you know, this is a guy becoming a professional. It just year by year trying to improve on a few things. But you're right, Noderman's a guy that the edge knows exactly what he's going to bring from the moment he touches the floor.
He's a quick release by Olivier Trois Fontaines on that three-pointer. He was shooting that, and he was still on the way up.
Yeah, and guys will do that, right? They'll have different timing releases depending on what the defense is giving them. So sometimes you shoot it on his way up or his faster shot. Some guys will get at their highest amount, and some guys will have to hold their shot for a second, having to go away from the shot blocking. So, but the thing is, Craig, you know, sometimes just the player is able to notice that or have that sensibility from our naked eyes outside. Good catch on that, but sometimes we can't even tell. But, you know, players have all kinds of different timings to their release.
And it's not necessarily something you even plan in advance as Rodriguez scores.
Correct. You got to play what the game is giving you. That's why it's so important to practice, you know, with the dynamic pressure points, right? Not everything is squared. You're going to get the same amount from every time. You got to shoot the fadeaways. You got to shoot the pump fakes. You got to shoot off balance, contested shots, set shots. You got to get all of those because they're going to happen in the real game.
Rodriguez putting on a clinic, getting around TJ Starks, and draws the foul.
He's like, all right, Starks, you got me too much on that other end. Let me get you before this first half goes through. So we can give each other a business card.
If Rodriguez hadn't gotten fouled there, I'm pretty sure Starks would have been touching earth in about a second. First free throw up and good for Angel Rodriguez. 17.7 to play in this second quarter. So the shot clock will be off for Juventus.
And 57 first half points, you know, after starting out with a lot of turnovers. You take this, Craig, you know, going into the half and putting up 57 is great.
And they're doing it in a sustainable way, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. 10 left on the game clock, shot clock is off. Here comes Scoochie Smith, driving left side. Scoop layup, no good. Got his own rebound, put up, won't go, but a foul called. Oh my goodness. Did they call a foul? No, they did not. So that's just the end of the second quarter. So it's Liège on top by 12, 57-45 in game one of the playoffs in the European North Basketball League between RSW Liège and Uniclub Casino Juventus. We are back at halftime to check out the stats and highlights in just a moment. Well, we'll keep it here for the highlights as we'll check out some of the stats on this game so far. We talked about how Liège is doing it sustainably, Victor. Liège, 62% overall from the floor, 22 of 35, just 4 of 11 from three-point range, 9 of 11 from the free throw line. So it's not like Liège put up 57 points in the first half by, you know, shooting 11 of 13 from three-point range or anything. They're just playing good, solid offense.
Yeah, yes they are, Craig, and they're doing it different ways. You see right here, Jamel Higgins with the outside shooting. They're also, after either they're getting scored on or getting the rebound, pushing the ball, even though Starks was, you know, a problem for them to handle the first half. But you see right there, Campbell getting that outside shot going of his. That's the reason why he's in there, is to shoot those shots, to make those shots. So to your point, they're being consistent. Trois Fontaine here from the left side. He's knocked down a few. He's got a bunch of ways that they're scoring. Let's see if they can keep going in the second half.
All right. We will check out the highlights, or we'll check out the stats in just a couple of moments. We are back live from Liège.
Is watching basketball at 3 in the morning enough? No, of course not. So you always wanted to be part of the team. Your own basketball club in your own backyard. What if I said you could? ENBL. 9 European countries, 15 pro teams, 60 games a season. The fastest growing basketball league in Europe. In the arena, on TV, or streaming live on your phone. Reach out to us and join the ENBL family. ENBL. Right here in your backyard.
Welcome back to Country Hall in Liège. It's halftime. RSW Liège leading Uniclub Casino Juventus 57-45 in game one of this two-game playoff series. The winner in aggregate points will advance to the next round. As we look at the individual numbers on this one, for Liège, EJ Anosike, 13 points, 2 rebounds. Graham Bogert, 7 points, 3 boards. Angel Rodriguez, 9 points, 2 rebounds, 5 assists, and just 1 turnover. Kevin Tumba, 4 points, 6 rebounds. Anthony Cambo, 5 points, 2 rebounds. Jamel Higgins has 10 points on 5 of 6 shooting. He's also got 2 rebounds, 2 assists. Brooke Lemaire has not scored. And Olivier Trois-Fontaine rounds out the scoring for Liège with 9. He's 2 of 4 from beyond the arc. For Juve, Ryan Taylor, 11 points. Ivan Vranis has 4. Scucci Smith, 7 points. He's got 3 turnovers in that first half. Zygmantas Skoutsis for Juve has 4 points. TJ Starks has 9. Adnan Penava has 4. Ernestas Sidorevicius has 4. Sarunas Anusis has 2. And that rounds out the scoring for Juve. Liège leading the rebounding battle 20-12. 12 assists to just 7. 9 turnovers to 7. Liège with 2 more, but they took much better care of that ball in the second quarter than they did in the first when they had 6 turnovers.
Yeah, Craig, you know,
so once again,
this is
the score at halftime. Go ahead.
No, Craig, you know, just to your point, you know, the numbers here don't lie. We have 57-45 for Liège, 12-point lead. And it goes to a lot, you know, the high percentage shooting, shooting at 62% at home, you know, that will really do it for you. Winning the rebounding battle, more assists, you know, they've controlled their turnovers after a bad start. So, you know, they got more points in the paint. They have more second chance points. They got more points in the fast break, points off turnovers. So, I mean, you really like what Liège brought to this first half. No surprise to us. You mentioned it. You know, this is a team that has this potential. This is a team that is capable of doing this.
57-45 at half. We're back in just a few moments.
Allowed easy shot to Juventus.
Thank you, coach.
In favor of Liège. That's the biggest lead of the game for the home team. And you always want to try to go into halftime on a high note. Sometimes you'll have a nice lead, and the team that's down will score a few buckets going into halftime, so you won't have momentum, but Liège has the momentum heading into halftime. Juve did get a little bit of a lead there, but Liège never let it get away from them. The most Juve led by was 3 points. Liège reeled them right back in, pulled up ahead, and got their biggest lead of this game thus far. And again, teams are playing 2 games back-to-back, home and home, and you advance on aggregate point totals. So every point counts. Liège up by 12. They've got themselves in a very good position heading into the second half. And if they're able to sustain this, heading into game number 2 of the series, which will take place next Wednesday at Juventus.
Yeah, Craig.
Let's get alongside Victor. My name is Craig Beta, and we will be back in just a few moments with the second half live from Country Hall in Liège. Back to Country Hall in Liège. RSOB Liège is hosting the club with Casino Juventus in game one of this two-game playoff series. These are the last two teams to get underway in the European North Basketball League playoffs. Cholet Tartu and Bakken all won their first playoff games. Well, they won by 8, Tartu by 7, and Bakken by 5. Right now, Liège is up 12, and if they are to hold on, they would be first place, kind of. They would have the largest differential, but it doesn't mean anything until the second game is played. And we are back underway alongside Victor Mansoure. I'm Craig Feta. Joining us wherever you're tuned in from. Victor, if Liège is going to be successful, if Liège is going to be successful in the second half, what do they have to do to close out Memphis?
It really starts from their defensive end. Giving up 45 points is not what they like, you know, because you know that Tony Juventus can really put up numbers in a hurry, and that's why they've gone with the zone defense here, 2-3, try to pack it in and cut away the ball penetration. So that's what you're hoping for, you feel the edge. Can we slow them down with a zone defense, you know, getting the high percentage shots on the offense? You know, they got Jamil Higgins on his spot. I mean, Rodriguez got to the rim when he had to. Antoine Fontaine shot his outside shot, you know, so I mean, guys just playing their roles have really helped out in Liège to fill out this lead. So can you be consistent here in the second half and bring in another 20 minutes of solid defense, good transition, and just smart decision-making for soft selection on the offensive end?
And an interesting tactic here by Alex Zampier. He's starting Jamil Higgins on the floor in the second half and having Kevin Tumba come off the bench. Not that Kevin Tumba played poorly. He had 4 points and 6 rebounds. Higgins,
yeah, but you know, that's
just giving Memphis all kinds of fits.
Yeah, you know, and you do that sometimes. You start out with a guy that can bring in that second unit and really push the tempo there. So we often say, Craig, not who starts, it's who finishes, and that's important. And Jamil Higgins is one of those examples. Now we had as Anthony Campbell gets called here for the reach in, we had Emmanuel Ginobili, who's one of the best international players of all time, one of the greats in the NBA, and he pretty much came off the bench his entire career for the Spurs, but would always be in the end of the game in that, you know, when it counts the most. So it's not who starts, it's who finishes.
The Edge with their biggest lead of the game so far at 16 points, and Rodriguez thought that was poked out of bounds by Ryan Taylor, but said he just lost it when he tried to go behind his back. Little mini band supporting Liège. Presumably father and son team have been there all season long with their drum and their bullhorn.
Yes, they have. Yes, they have, Craig.
Taylor steps up and knocks down that three-pointer. Campbell thought about launching the three from the corner, and now
Zeke wants
the fourth foul.
Yeah, because you have no option, right? And Zeke is just, you know, tremendous player of getting himself, you know, straight through the lane, go right underneath the rim and try to get position. The defender had nothing to do but to challenge that. He got called for the off-the-ball foul.
I mean, when you have Zeke and Higgins on the floor at the same time, it's like having the same, you know, two of the same guy out there. They're both so big, so strong, so athletic. Boy, how was that not a travel? Alex,
I thought so too.
Say the same thing. Got brought down to 7. Ronis scores.
That's going to count, and they're going to keep possession,
yeah.
Craig. This is going to be called on on our point guard here, Angel Rodriguez, and he got caught off the position, really, to see right there. Nice banging, got into his jump shot, and Rodriguez just underneath the screen there, just jiu-jitsu his man, just gave the man a judo vazari, and that's going to be called all day.
Judo vazari, huh?
Yeah, I think the vazari is when you win the judo match, right? I think that's what's called, right?
I don't know. I don't know. I mean, that's a Brazilian martial art, but
Maybe the judo fans that listen to us right now.
A turnover by Liège, but a good lucky break there as TJ Starks loses his footing and turns it back over. Seen some guys slipping around here tonight. I'm not sure what that's all about. It's, you know, I've been doing a tournament in South America last week, and where it was Monday night, it was still 97 degrees with 74% humidity in Santiago del Estero in Argentina, but it's certainly nothing like that. I mean, you can see why guys were slipping around there with all the perspiration on the floor and the humidity of the air, but I'm not sure why guys are slipping here so much tonight. Now Rodriguez and Starks get tied up. Cambo steps in, and then Starks shoves Cambo.
Yeah, well, this should
Rodriguez,
be a technical
Rodriguez
foul
tied
on Starks.
The, yeah, absolutely.
A delay a game on Rodriguez and a technical foul on Cambo. This is my quick interpretation here. Delay of game on Rodriguez. Technical foul on Starks right here for the push, and then also Cambo for getting in and pushing. Also,
yeah,
one tech each.
You could even get a T on Aiden Penava. So let's see how they adjudicate this.
They're gonna review it right there. They're making the signal for the review.
Yeah.
So they're going to make their way to the iPad, get a replay here. But,
original,
you know, if I had a...
The original
Craig.
Call, Victor, was a jump ball. It was Rodriguez came in and tied it up. Starks wouldn't let go. Rodriguez wouldn't let go of Starks. So Starks kind of shoved Rodriguez and threw an elbow a little bit. That's when Cambo stepped in and shoved Starks. And then Starks shoved Cambo back, and then Vranis, I think it was Vranis, came in and then shoved, no, it was Penava. Penava came in and shoved Cambo further.
But I tell you what, this can go the wrong direction for Liège here, Craig, because Angel Rodriguez had three fouls. He gets called for the foul there as a referee signal. So they put up the fourth foul on Rodriguez. And there's a sportsmanlike here and a sportsmanlike on 25 in Cambo. So Angel Rodriguez has four fouls now. And Starks and Cambo each get an unsportsmanlike on each side. But Angel Rodriguez now playing with the foul bonus, Craig. You know, having those four fouls, once again, he's a big piece of this team. So a lot of time left still. We're talking about there's still 17 minutes left in this game. And on a game that we're talking that is 80 minutes long because of combined aggregate. So,
yeah,
tough moment for Liège. And Liège putting Lemaire here at the point guard, resting on Rodriguez with that fourth foul now, having to save him for the end.
So Cambo and Starks both sit down. Rodriguez sits down as well, picking up that additional foul. So you've got Bogaerts and the mayor in the backcourt, along with Poifontaine. And it suddenly seems like the momentum has shifted to Juve. Although, had a bad turnover there, and now Taylor commits the foul.
Slick play here from Taylor, as you mentioned. You know, pretty much stopped the fast break, but the referees are going to call it a regular. So, interesting moment for Liège.
Yeah.
Put their heads right, get a couple of buckets here. They really need it.
Pop Fontaine for three. Ronis the rebound. And the blocking foul now on Higgins.
Yeah, they're
going to
start with the
free throw line.
Put the pressure on the referee right there. You see, obviously, not a charge. He was way off and on the Euro step, pretty much hit the side of his body. But Jamel Higgins putting the refs on check after, you know, the little bit of a scrum there a couple of minutes ago.
And I'm looking back at the play-by-play on the live stats, and they changed the unsportsmanlikes.
Uh-huh.
To personal. So Starks got a personal, Campbell got a personal, and Rodriguez all got personals. They previously did say unsportsmanlike.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm not sure if that was just a scoring change or if, you know, in the stat program and they actually were unsportsmanlike or what, but some bad blood brewing between these two teams. I don't know if Juventus is used to being down this much.
Yeah, you know, you got that point. You know, Juventus just thinking that they're the team that should come out with the win. You got Liège playing at home. You have two countries going at it, two different leagues going at it. And they're going to call a foul right here on this reach. Should have been a block. But you said referees now trying to keep the game close. We can get a little booze there in the back because of this. You know, a lot of foul calls. Still 6 minutes to go in the third quarter, and both teams already in the bonus, Craig. I like when things get physical, and then the referees let the physical go out of it by letting the players play, right? You don't want to be calling two touchy fouls. You want to keep things close, but not calling two touchy fouls.
Right.
I mean, these are two professional grown man team going at it. Let them figure it out.
So the lead now down to 7, 61-54. 5:50 to play third quarter, and now Juventus.
Fontaine smartly
over the limit as well.
Yeah, recognize Juventus is over the limit, so as soon as he caught it, the defender had his hands out. He just swiped through and hit the body of the defender. Easy call for the ref.
So as we look back at the foul situation, Angel Rodriguez has 4, Kevin Timba 3, Anthony Cambo 4, Jamel Higgins has 4. For Juventus, Skuchas has 4. Starks 3, Penova 3.
In a moment of the game where
Caleb,
you gotta keep your composure, right? You don't want your 12-point lead because, you know, of a couple of mistakes, now all of a sudden get blown out. Like, keep your composure. You're still winning this game by a good amount. Let's make sure that you keep growing on that and not blow your lead.
Bad decision there by Brook Lemaire to try to float that pass in the middle of three UA defenders. Shot is denied, but UA keeps possession. Timba had to be careful there. Lead is down to 6. Inside 5 minutes to play, third quarter. Lemaire puts that one off the window. No rebound, Vranis. Juve continuing to cut into this lead as Penova gets fouled. It's going to be on Anosike. Just the second foul on EJ. Penova, a 75% free throw shooter. 2 for 2 in this game. Make it 3 for 3. Victor Liège is doing a lot of looking around and shaking their heads and.
Yes.
Kind of discombobulated
because, you know,
right now.
Exactly. Ever since they've got into a little bit of a tangle, you like the fire, right? You like the fact that, hey, things are competitive here. It's going to get chippy. But then, you see, you got to keep your composure. And this is where Tumba's going to get called for the offensive foul. So discombobulated they have looked in the last 3 to 4 minutes, you know, after things got chippy. Now all of a sudden you lose your concentration. You're not attacking the rim as you were before. Your shot selection or even your offensive flow is not there. So tough moment here for Liège. They're not even going to look to see if there's extracurriculum or something that should not be there from Tumba. But to your point, Craig, tough moment. It was a 12-point lead. Now it's just down to four. So interested to see how quickly can you get back on track if you're Liège.
Well, it got up to a 16-point lead at 61-45. Since then, Juve has gone on a 13-1 run. I don't think anybody, certainly neither you nor I, expected that Liège was going to cruise through the second half without any adversity and continue to just run up the score on Juve. But let's see how they react. So far, since that little scrum, they have not reacted well. Here's Vranis on the block working on Noderman. So back outside, three on the way from Scoochie Smith. No, rebound Noderman. Fontaine left side, floats it to Anasike and a foul call.
Good transition. As soon as Craig, you know, Bolger's got the ball, gave the up ahead to Trois-Fontaine, and Trois-Fontaine recognized that Anasike had post play position and fed him right away. That's how you play in transition, man. As soon as you got something going on, a good matchup, you play through that, and then if you have nothing, then you get a reset.
Ball was on Jonas Jakas. Second free throw good. And the lead back to six. There's Jakas left side, guarded by Trois-Fontaine. Now Vranis working on Noderman again. Same spot as last time. Here comes the help from Trois-Fontaine. The hook shot is short. Rebound tracked down by Bogaerts. To Anosike. I'm not sure if he lost it or if he was trying to go behind the back or what, but either way, it's a turnover. Now the dish into the corner and an offensive foul. He kicked it out, but he ran over Brook LeBaire.
That's what the captain does, my friend. That's what he brings. That's the reason why he's the captain. Always thinking about his teammates, and that time giving up his body. Everybody in the crowd side too. LeMaire just great position, just waited for the man to pass the ball and run him over. So you appreciate what LeMaire brings to his team and sometimes don't even show in the stats.
Cover up those sensitive bits and brace for impact. Trois-Fontaine all the way himself. No, but Anosike's there for the tip dunk. Oh my.
My friend, that ball went up and looked like he went even higher. Never stopped going up, went to the seventh floor and threw that down with his armpit in the rim.
Scoochie misses from 16. Anosike pulls the rebound down. Trapped on the floor, gets it to Bogaerts. Bogaerts up ahead to Noderman, and he dunks it. No, it's not going to count, though.
Yeah, that was going to be an offensive foul the other way. Great positioning here. You see right there as Bogaerts took it. Boom.
Yeah, Bogaerts is
a little bit too
thing.
Late.
Noderman still hanging on the rim as he turns around to see what happened and why it didn't count. But
hey, you like the fact that Liège is getting on the floor, diving for those 50-50s. As there's a way for the ball here, foul call. Yep, on Bogaerts.
Oh, you're in a playoff game. You just can't do that in an aggregate series?
Yep.
Bogaerts should know better.
Yeah, but just like the turnovers hurt you, the technical fouls as well. So I agree with you, Craig. You got to keep the mistakes to the lowest minimum possible.
So Taylor shooting the free throw. And the lead is down to 7, 2:39 to play, third quarter. All into Scooches, he nearly lost it and fell over. Smith driving on Noderman.
Good defense.
Pick it up and give it up. Yeah. Now into the corner for Taylor for 3. That's good.
Yeah, that one, you live with that. You just don't want to help out from the corner. Knowing that the guy driving middle, his first option is going to be the corner. So enough help there, just a little bit too much over help, and found the guy open at the wing.
You know, CK guarded by Scooches. CK gives it up. Rebound, Bogaerts. Bogaerts way too far under the bucket to do anything with it. And then his pass gets intercepted by Jacques. Technical foul, by the way, was on the coach. It was not on Bram Bogaerts. And in a way, that's even worse because Alex Zampier should know better as well. Up ahead, Dutoit Fontaine. He finally tracks it down. No look pass to Bogaerts. And I don't know if he was expecting it, but he turns it over. And then commits the foul. Oh, man.
Yeah, tough break. You have a 4-on-2 situation. Not able to get a shot at the rim. Ended up fouling the guy afterwards. See right there as Twelve Fontaine took it himself. And then look at this, Craig. Woof! My friend, he got up there.
Boy, and for as good, and this is exactly what we talked about, Victor. As good as Liège looked when they had a 16-point lead earlier in this quarter, they've just gone out to lunch. The last 6 minutes of play here.
And they've stopped executing, Craig. You know, you can see their offensive flow. They're not getting into their pick and rolls or extra passes, possessions, you know. The ball's getting deflected a lot. They're turning the ball over. They're committing offensive fouls. So not a good stretch here for Liège. You got to try to get yourself together as Noderman gets them going. And hopefully this is going to be the break, kind of break the ice here offensively.
Big put back for Noderman. Yeah, it's hard to get an offensive flow when you got 4 guys sitting on the bench with 4 fouls apiece. Mm-hmm. That 3-pointer good by Jacques, and the lead down to 1 with 1 minute to play in the third quarter, and Liège players walking off the court. And looking at their body language, man, you can tell that they're in some distress right now.
Yeah, they are in some distress, you know, especially when they're playing the pick and roll situation. They're helping too much from the corner. And Manu Juventus have made them pay now twice here in the last 2 minutes. As soon as they get, you see right there, get to the elbow, find the guy for the open 3 and knock that one down. Nice over the head pass, quick release. So you don't want to be helping from the corners and giving up wide open 3s.
So for Liège, Rodriguez 4 fouls, Tumba 4 fouls, Cambo 4 fouls. Those are 3 of your starters. Higgins has 4 fouls. He's at times your best player on the floor. For Juventus, Scuchas has 4 fouls, 10 of a 4. Ryan Taylor with 3. Six more fouls called on Liège than on Juventus. So Bogaerts to inbound, finally gets it to Noderman. Now Anosike, inside of a minute to play, third quarter. Liège's lead cut down to 1.
Craig, you know,
Juventus
no need to panic.
The edge in this third quarter, 22-11. Yeah, no need to panic.
Stick with what has worked with you, and what has worked with you has been this post play by NSCK. He's got the potential to get into a little baby hook arc, which is a turnaround jumper. So play through your strengths, you know. NSCK down low, LaFontaine with the outside shooting, LeMaire getting his teammates going. Stick with the game plan. A lot of time left for you to still come up on top.
Shot clock at 5. Three-pointer is up and good for Scoochie Smith. Again, the lead down to 1.
Made his man scoot back and knock down the wide-open 3, Craig.
Shot clock off. Game clock at 7, now 6. LeMaire for 3. Short. We will go to the fourth quarter. Tied at 70, is that right? I had it 70-69. Yes, it's 70-70 is the score. So it's tied up at 70, heading into the fourth quarter. We are back in just a couple of moments, live from Liège, fourth quarter playoff action between Liège and Juventus.
Is watching basketball at 3 in the morning enough? No, of course not. So you always wanted to be part of the team, your own basketball club, in your own backyard. What if I said you could? ENBL. 9 European countries, 15 pro teams, 60 games a season. The fastest growing basketball league in Europe. In the arena, on TV, or streaming live on your phone. Reach out to us and join the ENBL family. ENBL. Right here in your backyard.
Tied up at 70, heading into the fourth quarter, playoff basketball action in the European North Basketball League between RSW Liège and Uniclub Casino Juventus. Two-game aggregate series, home and home. Liège led by as many as 16 points in that third quarter. They gave it all away, mostly because of foul trouble. Alex Zampier for Liège has had to piece together a lineup and try to get into the fourth quarter without losing the lead or getting too far down. Kevin Tumba back onto the floor now. He's playing with 4 fouls. Higgins and Rodriguez with 4 fouls. Alongside Victor Mansure, I'm Craig Feda. So glad you can be with us. And Victor, dire straits not right now for Liège, but Trois-Fontaine fouled on a 3-point shot there.
Yeah, Craig, you know, if you ask this Liège squad, are they going to go into the fourth quarter with the game tied, you know, 10 minutes to build their lead and win the first leg, they will take it, right? So even though the story of this game is they've had a 16-point lead, they're still in position, you know, here at home to try to do the damage. And it starts with good decision-making on the offensive end, and Trois-Fontaine is their volume guy, is their volume shooter. So you want to keep playing through him, especially if you got guys with foul trouble. And on the defensive end, can you be reliable? Obviously, you see Juventus now got going. They had 25 points there in the third. You got to keep that number down, hopefully below 20. And if that happens, then Liège has got themselves, you know, a position to win this ball game. But once again, solid defense. Don't get into foul trouble. They got into foul trouble way too early in the third. Obviously, yeah. After the scrum a little bit too, they lost their focus. So, Craig, you know, can you buckle down here and stick with the basics?
Juventus outscoring Liège 25-13 in that third quarter. Liège had put up 28 and 29 in the first two quarters of this game. And a CK, a little Euro. He wasn't called for the travel there because he didn't quite have full possession of the ball. Now LeMaire drives baseline, kicks it out. That one to the corner. And a whistle for a 3-second call.
Yeah, they're going to call Tumba for the 3-second. He didn't like it because he was the one setting the screen. And the fans didn't like it either, Craig. But, you know, Tumba's saying, I set the screen outside. How can I be 3 seconds in already after I was the roller? Yeah. So he might have an argument.
Lemaire battling with Vinicius. No call under the bucket, actually in the post area. The shot missed, rebound by Anosike. Fontaine. It outside. Bogaerts for three. No. Anosike, the offensive rebound. Fontaine for three is up and good.
No hesitation whatsoever. Fontaine just recognized he had daylight and he's already shooting without room. I imagine giving him room. So big three-pointer from the top of the key. Woodsley edge up by six, Craig. You know, and this is what we talked about. Stick with your guns. And one of those are the outside shooting, the triple threat of Fontaine. So after a three free throw trip, knocked down the big three, you go up by six, plenty of time. You see right there, no hezzy. He recognized he had room and just let it fly. And you love the after-curriculum there, you know. Guys just turning around, Craig, and saying, hey, don't put your hands on me. Don't push me. It's like, hold on a second. What are you doing? It's all fun. Nobody's going to do anything here. It's just you guys competing at the highest level.
Olivier, I just spoke with some people. To the rescue for RSW Liège.
I
was
spoken with some people from the Ohio region, Craig, and I've heard that you were a big trash talker back on your playing days. Is that true?
No. Actually, I hated trash talk. And I understand it's part of the culture.
You let the game do the talking, right? You let the game do the talking.
Yeah. I was even my best sport, football. I didn't trash talk much. I just tried to hit people really, really hard and let that do the talking. Tumba the block on the dunk attempt.
Talk about hitting, my friend. Go hit that at the glass. Bring it over. Bring that trash. Get that garbage out of here.
Oh, he absolutely stoned Scoochie Smith. And now Anosike with the tough bucket.
That has been a bright spot. Give Anosike the ball in the post and let him operate from that. Good things have happened for the Edge.
Endova hits the three-pointer straight through. He's a 21% three-point shooter. He just drained that one. The lead down to five. And a push by Penova. See this block by Tumba, no sir.
What a beauty, my friend.
Tumba leading the NBL in blocks at 1.7 per game. That was just his first in this one.
And plus the shot alteration he takes, right? So sometimes blocks, but sometimes he just alters the shot from the offensive player.
Bogaerts for three again, another miss, another offensive rebound by Anosike. Kicked out of bounds by Scoochie Smith. Graham Bogaerts, one for five three-point range in this game. He's a 27% three-point shooter. At some point, you got to stop launching those.
Yeah, they need him to get going.
Fontaine misses, but there's Anosike.
Talking about get going, my friend. Anosike is getting going. Everything at the rim, just having dinner up there.
Stark's fadeaway is short. And now the lead is seven for Liège. 7.5 minutes to play. Fourth quarter, a little breathing room, but not nearly enough. When you have players with four fouls and Bogaerts slips, I thought he stepped on the sideline when he began his drive. Instead, he slipped here and turned it over. Rodriguez in the game with four fouls. Tumba in the game with four fouls. Cambo back in with four fouls. Mel Hagan sits down with four. Profontaine gets a rest as well. We will certainly see Profontaine and Hagan's back in before this one's over. Trois Fontaine still in the game. So it's Anosike, Bogarts, Tumba, Lemaire, and Trois Fontaine. Tumba falls over. Great hustle by Liège getting back to stop that transition opportunity.
The refs are letting them play here, Craig.
Yeah. Anosike, the steal nearly. Bogarts couldn't track it down, and it went off of him out of bounds. So it's going to be Juventus ball with eight on the shot clock. Now Tumba sits back down.
What a privilege for Coach Zamplier. He's, you know, take out Tumba, who's been a great defensive presence. Now you put in Jamil Hagans, a guy who can score, and obviously you've had Anosike all night long being able to put up his own. So their front court really having an impact in the game.
Anosike takes it himself, has his shot blocked. Hagans gets the rebound, and then he gets fouled on the way up. That's going to be on Bronis.
There's an example right there. Your front court just taking matters into their own hands. Anosike sees daylight. He attacks, perhaps got fouls, got hit in the rim, on the arm there. And then you got Jamil Hagans falling up and him bullying ball down there. So, you know, your front court really putting a stamp on this game. So if you're the edge, you appreciate that. And once again, you have to play off of that on your play call.
Boy, I love, if they weren't playing with foul trouble, I love this lineup right now for Liège. You got Hagans and Anosike, who are almost the same identical player. You've got Rodriguez at the point. You've got Fontaine at your two. Right there by Ernestis Sedorevicius. Back down to seven. Anosike around the screen by Trois Fontaine gives it up. Olivier Trois Fontaine from the top of the key drains another three.
Yeah, he just jab stabbed his man just to get him off a little bit and then, you know, elevated, even though he was contested. A straight shooter, man, from the top of the key like that, nothing but the bottom. So under control for Trois Fontaine, knew exactly what he was doing. See right there, jab step, get him away from you, pull it up, bottoms, let him know.
Olivier Trois Fontaine, 19 points. He's 4 of 10 overall, 4 of 8 from three-point range. EJ Anosike, 23 points. Anel Rodriguez, 11. Jamil Hagans, 14. Starks. Can't get his shot to go. Rebound, Anosike. Eighth rebound for EJ Anosike. Bogarts has eight boards. Tumba has seven. And Victor, look at the rebounding disparity. Liège, 41 rebounds. Juventus, just 17.
Yep. And that's because, you know, Liège is being the team that, you know, offensively is shooting a high percentage, not allowing Juventus any rebounding opportunity. So if you attack the rim as well, they're shooting 86% from the free throw line, Greg, on 11 for 22. So if you had a good field goal percentage and a good free throw percentage, that's really going to put pressure on the glass for Juventus. And we cannot take, we talk about the front court, you cannot take away from the 14 offensive rebounds. You know, Jamil Hagan's got three, and Anosike's got five, so that really adds up for second chance points.
And all kinds of frustration now for Juventus as TJ Starks, prior to even inbounding that ball, he wasn't sure what was going on the floor, and then he tried to zip that pass in. There was nobody there, and he was frustrated on his way back up defensively. Now inside 5 minutes to play. The Liège lead is 10. Rodriguez to Anosike. Angel gets it back. Bogaerts and a whistle for the shot. As Bogaerts launched another three, it will not count, but man, at some point, Alexander is going to have to talk to Bram Bogaerts and say, son, you're not shooting real well from the arc. You may want to consider driving or, you know, taking some steps in and taking a shorter shot.
Yeah, those adjustments are part of the game, right? I mean, everybody at some point in the season or during the game have to make those adjustments. And the adjustments that Liège is making is putting Jamel Higgins in the pick and roll, you see right there, because he's going to draw attention, go into the rim, and he's going to open the perimeter for outside shooters.
Rodriguez missed the three-point attempt after another offensive rebound, that one by Bogaerts. No call at the rack. Wow. And now at the other end, and Osike gets fouled. And Ivan Vranis talking with the officials about the lack of a call at the other end. You had three guys from Juve complaining. That foul going to be on Sedorevicius.
Yeah, and it looked right, unless Angel Rodriguez got the block, because, I mean, he completely missed the power layup underneath the basket. The ball went on the other side of the backboard, so either it was a block or a foul. Referees, no call. Anasike doing what he does best, man. Heads down towards the rim, shoulder to shoulder, a blocking foul, and he knocked down the first free throw.
Lead back to 12. Liège has outscored Juve in this fourth quarter, 17-5. That three-pointer short, and how do you like that for responding to adversity? Liège gave up a 16-point third-quarter lead to be tied heading into the fourth, and they just took a breath, got their head right. Now Higgins!
See right there, my friend, big body play, just roll to the basket. And Rodriguez pretty much just flopped that ball in. He just kind of gave a little baby pass to him, and he was able to control it while spinning, moving, and finish at the rim. So if you're Liège, once again, play through Higgins offensively. That's going to create some space. And then defensively, even though they're slowing down, we talked about the slowdown of Juventus. We got to keep that going here for the last 3 minutes, Craig, and remind everyone that this is an aggregate, so back-to-back games, the point differential here, very important to carry over.
Rodriguez commits his third turnover as he spins and stumbles in the lane. And Osike has three turnovers, but he's shot the ball 18 times. He's got 25 points. Bogaerts, five turnovers. Rodriguez, three. Tumba has four. Now a travel called on Vranis.
And this is a rare travel call because he reversed pivot, was facing Higgins face to face. And, you know, sometimes in the perimeter, you would lift up your pivot foot before you put the ball on the ground.
Yeah.
Very hard to see when you're in the post, but the referee saw it, man. So good call.
Rodriguez beats Higgins, and he gets it to go.
Yeah, Rodriguez just knowing how to, you know, really find his way, S-ing his way into the lane, and just found a, you know, we talk about the passes, we talk about over the head and chest pass and bounce pass, but a lot of times you have to know that the passing angles are underneath the armpits of the player, or by their ears, right? These are two areas that the defender really sometimes cannot, you know, goalkeeper that or deflect that. So Angel Rodriguez that time just wrapped around the pass around the waist area into Jamel Higgins for the open deuce.
Higgins now 18 points on 7 of 8 shooting. Croix-Fontaine's got 19, he's 4 of 9 from the arc, and Osike 25 points. Bogaerts. Oh, he thought Higgins was going to go up. He tried to get him for the oop. Higgins didn't read it.
This is a moment where every possession really counts, Craig. You know, so if you're Liège, 2:22 to go. We're talking about five or six possessions to each team. So 12-point lead. You're really playing to perhaps finish this game with a 16 to 18 points.
Right now, and another Juventus turnover. That was their 12th. Am I reading this right? Liège has 23 turnovers?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm reading that right. Right, Victor? I mean, I don't need to clean my glasses. 23 turnovers?
No, they have the stat sheet. I believe it's a little bit off sometimes, but the wrong call. But no, you're right, man. It's 23 and still winning this ball game. Go figure.
So the lead down to 12. Liège a little bit lackadaisical on and after that possession led to the easy bucket for Juventus. And Zampier might want to call timeout here and just remind them, hey, boys, this is an aggregate thing. Don't get too cute here. Another miss from the arc for Bogaerts. He wanted a foul call. Bogaerts now 1 of 6 from three-point range. Turn around short, Bogaerts the rebound. That's his 10th board. For the amount of turnovers,
spread the
court
here.
Dominating really offense, dominating the glass, 47 to 19.
Yeah, you know, 24 turnovers, Craig. Really what has helped them here is the high percentage shooting, right? They're 32 for 61, and obviously the rebounds, the 46 rebounds to 19. So if it wasn't for those stats, you really could see them, and obviously just the poor three-point shooting from Juventus is a 9 for 27. So
now,
you know, to your point.
Victor, we've got some extracurriculars now going on again. As Trois-Fontaines in front of the bench was getting pushed by one of the Juventus players. I didn't see who.
Yeah, me neither. Looking at my stats here, if we can get a replay.
Oh. Yeah, there's no need for this. The Liège players just need to go back to their bench.
Yeah, you want to be smart, right? You don't want to put in fire or put wood into the fire because you know this is a playoff game. You're going to have to go back-to-back. So you're still going into Lithuania. So you don't want to give teams arguments or, you know, just enough fuel, enough motivation than what they already have as a professional team.
Plus, that gets the crowd fired up when they go back to Lithuania as well if they're watching this back there. They will not have friendly reception for Liège.
No, you being a superstar that I know at the U19s, you know, World Championship where people love you in Lithuania.
Yeah.
Let's see if they're going to love us now.
And again, that's how I know how to pronounce a lot of these names, is from doing that work in that U19 tournament. And Victor's only half joking. I did develop a little bit of a following in Lithuania during that tournament. They were spamming the FIBA offices with email requesting me to do their games.
Hey, man, I sign off on that too, my friend. There's a reason why. not just Lithuania. I love it, my friend. But you see right there, guys just having a good time, man. It just gets competitive. So, you know, nothing wrong with it, honestly. As long as it's clean, you know, there's no punches being thrown or anything like that. A little pushing and shoving don't hurt nobody. It's all good.
Guys like Jabel Higgins and Scoochie Smith, you know, they're standing there talking. They know what's going on. But some of the other guys take it a little too seriously and get a little too amped up by a little bit of, you know, physical activity.
Hey, man, this happens everywhere. You go down to the park, you might see some action like this, right? Where guys are trash talking, especially in the end of the game, right? You're putting your frustration out. See what the call here is, because it's a 10-point lead, right? And obviously you want to increase it. You don't want to blow this into single digits. So let's see what the refs call. And interesting.
Rodriguez has one more free throw coming after the foul by Scucci. And then we'll have to see what happens after that as far as any other technical fouls or anything else goes. So they're not going to call anything else, it looks like. So Rodriguez has one more free throw to come. You get the lead back to 12, currently 92-81. Hill 4-for-4 from the free throw line in this game. Make it 5-for-5, and the lead is back to 12. And now Oliver Kostitz wants timeout. Zampier taking timeout again. And again, this is a good situation for him to remind his team that this is an aggregate playoff series. Don't give him any, you know, easy fouls where they can, you know, score 3 or 4 points at the line. I mean, yeah, you still come away with the win, but in an aggregate series, going to the other team's home floor next, you need every point you can get. No technicals, no unsportsmanlikes, none of that stuff that they're going to get easy points on.
And these are the situations that you practice during the year, Craig. A lot of times, you know, in practices, you have what we call situational practices. So you put up 2 minutes, you're down 10, in this case, a minute seven, and you're down 12. Can you bring this score closer, or at least not give up anymore if you are in the Juventus.
Juve ball, TJ Starks to inbound. Looking, finally gets it in and gets it back.
Good play,
Gucci open for three, no good.
Good play call, Craig. They had two guys.
How is that?
I'm gonna translate what. Yeah. So because what happens is as the play was being made in the baseline, the argument is that, you know, that Smith was trying to get the ball and the referee was in his way and did not allow him room to put that ball back. Watch this. As a good play call, open three, follow his shot on the miss. As he's going to get it right there, he's saying that the referee was on his way, but he had already.
No. He stepped on the baseline and then tapped the ball. So they went and looked at that,
right?
And that is going to be Liège ball, yeah. Yeah, the official was a good 6 feet off the floor. He was backing up near the camera there when Scucci came into contact with the ball and his foot on the baseline. So they looked at it and got the call right, and that's the most important thing. And they're very nearly, and Osike didn't get his foot established inbounds. Jay on the drive, getting it out to Rodriguez.
Need space in here.
Lafontaine, back to Osike. Five on the shot clock, Osike, that's gonna be a travel. Either way, you burned up 22 seconds on the shot clock. And you've still got a 12-point lead. You don't allow them a transition bucket here. So that's just as good as a missed shot. Starks over to Taylor. Taylor for three. That's good.
Yeah, Taylor put Noderman on his heels. and then protecting,
yeah,
pretended like he was going to attack and hold up for the three. Big three, Craig, you know, you put that lead from 12 down to 9. So you feel the edge, you're trying to get a bucket here.
Yeah, you want to at least get it back to double figures. So you start up in Lithuania with a 10-0 lead.
Yeah, so good timeout.
Once again, game two of this series next Wednesday, March 20th, at Juventus. It's going to be aggregate series. With more points after two games, will advance. The next game for Liège will be Friday in BNXT Elite Gold Play against Lanstedt. That game at 8 p.m. local time, 3 p.m. Eastern time in the USA. So Liège will have the ball. Juve's half. Ogaerts to inbound. LaFontaine back to Hagens. Now Rodriguez. Ooh, Rodriguez very nearly turned it over. Gets it to Hagens. Shot clock at 5. Back to Angel. High off the glass and in.
Yeah, great job recognizing that, you know, Juventus is overplaying the passing lanes. So after he got the ball, Rodriguez got the ball, Jermaine Hagens just kept going on a give and go and got himself through the lane for a nice easy deuce, a nice arcing shot for the easy deuce. Important bucket, Craig. We talk about the pointed differential. You know, all of a sudden you had it, and you go back now. With a bucket here. So very, very important points for Mr. Angel Rodriguez. See right there, keep cutting to the basket, man. Don't lose sight of the ball. Nice catch and concentration for that finish.
So now if you're Liège, you know Juventus is going to try to get a three-pointer here to cut down on this aggregate. Obviously, trailing by 11 with 17 seconds left, the game has been decided because I don't see that Reggie Miller is suited up for Juventus. But you will assume that they're going to try to get a good look at a three-pointer here to cut down on this differential.
Yeah. If I'm Liège, the house rules here are contest the threes, do not foul, and stay in front of your defender in case they're driving to the basket. If you do one of those three, we're in good shape.
Well, there is the three-point attempt by Starks. It was no good.
Ten
rebounded
seconds.
By Tumba.
They should attack. Yeah, he should attack here.
Mm. And Noderman that was trying to do that. It went off of Juve, so it's going to be Liège ball with 4.5 to play, and they are going to draw up something here. They're not just going to try to dribble it out.
No, you're trying to score here. I would even bring in Jamil Hagens. They don't.
Rodriguez inbounds to Trois-Fontaines for three. Rolls off. Rodriguez got his fingers on the rebound. Now from half court, that shot falls well short, and Liège with a 95-84 win in game one of this home-and-home aggregate playoff series. So a big win for RSW Liège on their home floor. And Oliver Kostic is furious about something. Liège players walking through the line and Kostic is having none of it. Still trying to see what he's up to, if he's even shaking hands with anybody. He's headed back over to the, well, he went back to his team huddle now as both teams are huddling up, and now the official's leaving the court. So Liège Wins game one, 95-84. Liège 51% overall, 24% from the three-point line. That mostly the Bram Bogert, one of six. Olivier Trois-Fontaine, four of 10. As we roll the highlights, we'll run through the stats here. Juventus, 27 of 65 for 41%, 10 of 30 from three-point range for 33%, 20 of 22 as a team from the free throw line for 90%. Liège was 23 of 26 for 88%, so both teams outstanding from the stripe in this game. Liège, a monster game on the glass, 49-21 the rebounding advantage. Liège committed an eye-popping, mind-blowing 25 turnovers and still won the game by 11 points. I think that tells you how well they played for most of this game. Just 12 turnovers for Juve. For Liège, IJ Anosike, 25 points, 9 rebounds, 3 assists. Bram Bogert, 7 points, 10 rebounds. Also had 7 turnovers. Angel Rodriguez, 15 points, 5 boards, 8 dimes. Kevin Tumba, 4 points, 8 rebounds. Anthony Cambo, 5 points, 2 rebounds. Mel Hagans, 18 points on 7 of 9 shooting. Also 3 rebounds, 4 assists. Sean Noderman, 2 points. 2 big points in the third quarter. Rather at the start of the fourth quarter, by the way. 2 rebounds for Noderman. And Olivier Trois-Fontaine, 19 points on 4 of 10 shooting from the arc. He also had 4 rebounds. For Juve, Ryan Taylor, 23 points. Grannis had 8. Gucci Smith, 14. Skuchas had 6. Starks, 11. Penava, 11. Jacques had 3. Sedorovic, 6. And Yusis had 2. Leading rebounder for Juve. Well, they had about 5 guys with 3 rebounds apiece, and Jacques led with 3 assists. So, Victor, closing thoughts on this big Liège win.
Big win for the home team, Craig. They needed a stamp. They got the stamp. 11-point advantage going into the aggregate back-to-back game. They know they have enough. 31 minutes, 25 points from Anasike. Obviously, Angel Rodriguez, 15 points, 8 assists. 10 rebounds for Bulger, so they have enough going into the second leg to try to come up with a win there as well and advance the playoffs.
Game two next Wednesday at Juventus. Liège with a chance to advance in ENBL play. For my partner, Victor Mansure, my name's Craig Fata, saying so long for now, and thanks for watching.